Bigfoot, the Loch Ness Monster, ghosts, aliens, none of these things can be proven to exist with actual facts or science, yet so many people believe in them and are very passionate about those beliefs.
The new book, Pseudoscience, An Amusing History of Crackpot Ideas and Why We Love Them, looks at the history of these popular ideas and phenomena and the fascination with things we know aren't true. Joining us are the authors, Dr. Lydia Kang, and also who is an internal medicine specialist, and Nate Pedersen, who's a librarian and historian. Good morning to both of you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You know what? I am always fascinated by the amount of TV specials about Bigfoot and the Loch Ness Monster. And I was terrified of that Bermuda Triangle growing up.
I thought it was coming to my house to get me.
And so what is people, even when people hear evidence that things are not true, why do they continue to believe it? What's the science behind that?
Well, I think that there's just a need for people to really want to envelop themselves in mystery when there isn't a whole lot of mystery left in this world. I also am somebody who grew up with those shows like In Search Of and hearing about Bigfoot. And it's absolutely tantalizing and fun to think that there are creatures out there and other things like UFOs, UAP, that we don't have an answer for.
And Nate, some of it can be, you know, fun, I suppose. Is there a harm at some point in maybe some of these concepts?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, people are drawn to pseudoscience because it provides simple answers to complex problems. And that can be, an issue over time. It plays into a general mistrust you might have of institutions or a lack of patience in the scientific process completely unfolding, right? Like scientific evidence takes time to produce results, and we need to be patient as we wait for those results to come in.
So what's the harm in just letting people, you know, investigate and keep, you know, hunting in the woods for Bigfoot?
I think there is just a range of harm when it comes to pseudoscience. You know, like some things are fairly harmless. Who doesn't kind of enjoy peeking at their horoscope, you know, here and there, or taking one of those personality tests to sort of learn a little bit more about themselves? I think it just becomes a little bit more harmful when we think of things that have huge impacts and can actually hurt people. So just ignoring that climate change is a thing, I think there are consequences to that. But a lot of the stuff we look at in this book was really out of just sort of fun and taking a historical perspective on some of the things that we've looked at and also having a little fun with it.
Well, I think it's a good learning opportunity too. And maybe we can look at specific examples of what's the disconnect on something. I think Bigfoot's obviously ridiculous, but let's talk about astrology. What about astrology do people think is happening that really is not happening scientifically?
Well, with astrology, you know, there's a lot of people who are like, okay, I'm an expert at reading natal charts, and they have like the science down to like exactly how to put together all this information about what your life is like based on exactly the hour that you were born and what year, what month, all that kind of stuff. But if you actually do some of the data behind it, if you actually test some of these people, the testing doesn't really come out to be very accurate. So, you know, if you're putting in thousands of dollars into, you know, astrology and buying things, like that's kind of not a great idea when the science doesn't back it at all. But people love the idea of looking to the stars, looking to the skies to help guide them, because honestly, we live in a really complicated world and we all need a little guidance.
So Nate, when you're doing a book like this, I'm sure you're collecting all these things like, oh yeah, remember when people believe, you know, the crop circles, this kind of thing. And I still don't know who's making those crop circles. Yeah. And what happened to those planes in the Bermuda Triangle? Anyway, what's the weirdest when you say crackpot ideas? Did you hear one that you're like, I can't believe people believe this?
Yes, using chickens to interpret the will of the gods, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, Lydia just talked a little bit about how we all have this urge to look for ways to make our decision-making process a little bit easier. And in ancient Rome, they perfected the art of using chickens for that very process. So major statecraft, major political decisions, major military decisions were made in ancient Rome frequently by virtue of what a chicken did or didn't do and how a person interpreted that behavior. Yeah. And we've happily moved on from that.
Well, one of the common themes that I think media is responsible for is ghosts, because they're good stories. And you see the ghost hunters with their little Radio Shack devices measuring lots of energy and audio signals or whatever. What is the disconnect in their perceived science there?
Well, the thing is that when they're searching for ghosts and when they're trying to get actual proof of them, it's not really provable. And so therein lies the problem. A lot of pseudoscience has this one core element, which is that you can't prove what they're saying is there or not there. And so because of that, you can't do scientific testing. And so the science can't ever really truly back it up. And there's a lot of stuff also just confirmation bias and the fact that we like to find faces and fuzzy objects and things like that. Our brains have a tendency to do that. And there's a lot of anecdotal evidence. So these are some of the hallmarks of pseudoscience, and they're not part of real science, unfortunately.
Well,
But we all like to believe a ghost story.
The book is Pseudoscience, an Amusing History of Crackpot Ideas and Why We Love Them. You can get more at Lydia and Nate's sites on the socials. There they are. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.